Listening Library presents The Dark 30, Southern Tales of the Supernatural by Patricia McKissack. Read for you by Allyson Johnson and Mirron Willis.
To my grandmother, Sarah Jane James, PCM. To my wife, Andrea, BP. Author's note. When I was growing up in the South, we kids called the half hour just before nightfall the Dark 30. We had exactly half an hour to get home before the monsters came out. During the hot, muggy summer, when days last longer, we gathered on the front porch to pass away the evening hours. Grandmama's hands were always busy, but while shelling peas or picking greens, she told a spine-chilling ghost tale about Laughing Lizzie, a specter who'd gone mad after losing her entire family in a fire. Her hysterical laughter was said to drive listeners insane. Then, on cold winter nights when the Dark 30 came early, our family sat in the living room and talked. The talk generally led to one of Grandmama's hair-raising tales. As the last glimmers of light faded from the window overlooking the woods, she told about Gray Jim, the runaway slave who'd been killed while trying to escape. Gray Jim's ghost haunted the woods on moonless nights.
"Sorry for those who hear Gray Jim's dying screams," she whispered, "'cause they're not long for this world."
At this point, my grandmother would pause and say,
"Pat, go in the kitchen and get me a glass of water."
Many years later, I learned that Laughing Lizzie and Gray Jim had been real people in our small African-American community. The strange and often sad circumstances of their deaths had inspired the ghost stories that lived after them. They inspired me, too. The Dark 30, Southern Tales of the Supernatural, is a collection of original stories rooted in African-American history and the oral storytelling tradition. They should be shared at that special time when it is neither day nor night, and when shapes and shadows play tricks on the mind. When you feel fear tingling in your toes and zinging up your spine like a closing zipper, you have experienced the delicious horror of a tale of the Dark 30. Patricia C. McKissack, 1992. The Legend of Pin Oak. In 1868, a Kentucky artist, Thomas Satterwhite Noble, painted The Price of Blood, which shows the sale of a mulatto slave by his father master to illustrate the cruelty of slavery. There is no greater horror than a system that allows parents to sell their children, or, as in this story, brother to sell brother.
The Legend of Pin Oak. The plantation bell summoned everybody to the big house. About 50 slaves, including the inside help, gathered in front of the white mansion. Among them were Henry and his wife Charlemagne. Harper McAvoy, looking pale and weak, stood beside one of the big Doric columns that supported the second-story porch. After nervously clearing his throat, he announced in a not-so-steady voice, "I've sold Henry." One of the slaves screamed. Charlemagne, perhaps. Harper didn't know for sure. As he hurried back inside the house, voices called after him, "No, not Henry. Massa, what about Charlemagne and the baby? Who will see after things round here? What will become of us all?" Harper raced to his study, where he barricaded himself against the onslaught of questions. "I sold Henry," he said, giggling foolishly. "I did it. Now I'll be rid of him." Suddenly, the door to his study burst open. "Do you hate me that much?" Henry asked without hesitation. "Enough to destroy Pin Oak?" Harper scurried behind his desk to put a barrier between them. "I owe you no explanation. You're my slave." Harper's resentment of Henry began in childhood. Actually, this story started with Amos McAvoy, the former master of Pin Oak. Amos had inherited the estate from his father, Thomas McAvoy, who had built it the same year Thomas Jefferson was elected President of the United States. Only Andrew Jackson's Hermitage equaled Pin Oak's graceful architectural styling and elegant setting. Amos McAvoy had been a tall, red-headed man with a square-cut chin and deep-set green eyes. He'd courted the lovely Alva Dean from Spring Manor and won her over with his dashing style and devil-may-care charm. Their spring wedding united two old Tennessee families, the Deans and the McAvoys, two fortunes and two hearts. But the marriage lasted only a year. The night they told Amos that Alva had died in childbirth, he locked himself in her room and wept bitterly. When Amos finally emerged the next morning, he named his son Harper, then abandoned Pin Oak, leaving it to be run by overseers. For 10 years, Harper saw Amos only a few weeks during harvest season. The rest of the time, his father stayed in New Orleans. The boy was left in the charge of his grandmother, Dean, who showered him with everything her money could buy. But material possessions and her love were no substitute for the thing he most desired: his father's acceptance. "He would rather I had died," Harper told his grandmother. And no matter how much Amanda Dean tried to deny it, they both knew it was true. To ease his pain, Harper taught himself not to care. Then one day, Amos unexpectedly arrived at the Dean's Spring Manor. Harper slipped down the steps and stood outside the parlor, where he listened to the conversation. "I'm turning to Pin Oak," Amos said, "and I want my son to come live with me."
"There's nothing I can do to stop you," Amanda answered coldly. "But why now, after all these years? You've never taken the slightest interest in the boy before."
"I know, and it was wrong," he admitted, "but I plan to make it up. I left my affairs in the care of others far too long." Amanda sighed deeply. "Harper is a complicated child. I don't think he knows how to be happy. I've spoiled him, I know. Perhaps it will be good for him to be with you."
"Yes, from now on, things will be better."
Harper had lived at Pin Oak for about a month when his father announced that he was going to New Orleans. He returned several weeks later with Henry, a mulatto child about 2 years younger than Harper. The boy had a mop of dark red hair, a square chin, and unusual pale green eyes. Gossip spread quickly from the big house to the quarters. "Say the boy's mama was one of them free blacks down in New Orleans," Harper overheard the cook tell the driver. "Got his mama's skin and his daddy's green eyes. An odd combination."
"That's for sure. Anybody with eyes can clearly see that Henry is Massa Amos's own flesh and blood."
Harper saw what everybody else saw. The McAvoys were big, strong, athletic men with ruddy complexions. Henry, though younger, was taller and more solidly built than Harper. A frail child with the same pastel features as his mother, Harper hated the way he looked and despised Henry for looking so much like their father. What was worse, Amos never denied a word of the gossip. Even if he had, it wouldn't have stopped the tongues from wagging.
"So, it's all true," Amanda Dean gasped when she came to Pin Oak, admittedly to see Henry.
She fell into a chair and fanned herself, then turned to Amos.
"You and that boy are the talk of two counties. Now I see why."
Amos sent Henry on an errand so that he could speak freely to Amanda.
"The child's mother is dead, and I didn't want him with somebody who might mistreat him."
"How dare you shame my grandson with this abomination? I've come to take Hopper back to Spring Manor."
"No, the boy stays here," he answered. "Henry will be a good companion for Harper. I brought him home for that purpose."
"Are you so blind?"
Amanda said, pointing an accusing finger.
This can only lead to disaster.
Amos ignored his mother-in-law's counsel and installed Henry as a house servant. In time, however, Henry was put in charge of Amos's stables. Pen Oak's horses were some of the finest in the state, and Amos was a gifted horseman. Henry enjoyed taking care of Hercules, Amos's prize stallion. Harper, on the other hand, stayed as far from the stables as possible. Horses made him sneeze, and riding them made him sore.
I'm hot,
Harper complained when Amos took both boys out to view the fields.
And besides, I'm not interested in how cotton grows.
Stop whining, Harper, Amos scolded. You'll be master of Pin Oak one day. And Henry, you'll run the place. That's the way I want it.
The seasons passed swiftly, until at last Henry reached manhood, tall, confident, and strong. Harper's jealousy of Henry grew each year until it dominated his life, and he was immersed in an ever-widening pool of anger and hatred. Just as Amos planned it, Henry was put in charge of Pin Oak operations. Soon after, Amos approved his marriage to Charlemagne, a beautiful African woman. Together, they built a cabin with a stone fireplace, wood floors, and shuttered windows. It wasn't until then that Amos told Henry he was free.
Your mama was freed by her master when she was born. I've never told you before now because I didn't want you running off when you were too young to take care of yourself. You're 25, and the law says I have to let you go.
I've always known I was free, Henry said. My mama told me many times before she died.
Will you be leaving Pin Oak?
Amos asked. Henry sighed.
No, because Charlemagne belongs to you, and she couldn't come with me.
I'll stay and keep running Pin Oak, but for a salary. And I want to use that salary to buy Charlemagne's freedom.
A wise decision, Amos said, smiling.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.